Simon & Schuster Audio presents Grave Secrets by Kathy Reichs. Read by Katherine Borowitz.
I am dead. They killed me as well.
The old woman's words cut straight to my heart.
Please tell me what happened that day.
Maria spoke so softly I had to strain to catch the Spanish.
I kissed the little ones and left for market.
Eyes down, voice toneless.
I did not know that I would never see them again. When did you return home, Señora Chip?
A qué hora regresó usted a su casa, Señora Chip?
Late afternoon, I'd sold my beans.
The house was burning?
Yes.
Your family was inside?
A nod. I watched the speakers, an ancient Mayan woman and the young cultural anthropologist Maria Pais calling up a memory too terrible for words. I felt anger and sorrow clash inside me like the thunderheads.
What did you do? We buried them in the well, quickly before the soldiers came back.
I studied the old woman. Her face was brown corduroy, her hands were calloused, her long braid more gray than black. The woman did not smile. She did not frown. Her eyes met no one's, to my relief. I knew if they lingered on mine, even briefly, the transfer of pain would be brutal. Feeling dizzy, I upended a bucket, sat, and took in my surroundings. I was 6,000 feet up, in the western highlands of Guatemala, at the bottom of a steep-sided gorge. The village of Chupan Ya, between the mountains. About 125 kilometers northwest of Guatemala City. Around me flowed a wide river of green, lush forest interspersed with small fields and garden plots, like islands. Mist clung to the highest peaks, blurring their contours into Monet softness. I'd rarely seen surroundings so beautiful. The loveliness of the backdrop made the task at hand even more heartbreaking. As a forensic anthropologist, it is my job to unearth and study the dead. I identify the burned, the mummified, the decomposed, and the skeletonized who might otherwise go to anonymous graves. I have learned to steel myself emotionally in order to practice my profession. But the old woman was breaking through my determined detachment. Another wave of vertigo. The altitude, I told myself, lowering my head and breathing deeply. Though my home bases are North Carolina and Quebec, where I serve as forensic anthropologist to both jurisdictions, I'd volunteered to come to Guatemala for 1 month as temporary consultant to the Fundación de Antropología Forense de Guatemala. The Guatemalan Forensic Anthropology Foundation, FAFG, was working to locate and identify the remains of those who vanished during the 1962 to 1996 Civil War, one of the bloodiest conflicts in Latin American history. And I had come to help. I'd learned a lot since my arrival 1 week before. Estimates of the missing ranged from 1 to 200,000. The bulk of the slaughter was carried out by the Guatemalan army and by paramilitary organizations affiliated with the army. Most of those killed were rural peasants. Many were women and children. Here in Chupan Ya, soldiers and civil patrollers had entered on an August morning in 1982. Fearing they'd be accused of collaborating with the local guerrilla movement and punished, the men fled. The women were told to gather with their children at designated farms. Trusting, or perhaps fearing, the military, they obeyed. When the soldiers located the women where they'd been sent, they raped them for hours, then killed them, along with their kids. Every house in the valley was burned to the ground. 23 women and children were said to lie at the bottom of the well behind Señora Chip. The old woman continued her story. Over her shoulder, I could see the structure we'd erected 3 days earlier to protect the well site from rain and sun. Rope had been strung from pole to pole around the excavation to create a boundary between spectators and workers. Inside the restraint sat three idle members of the FAFG team. Outside it stood the villagers who came each day to observe in silence, and the police guards who'd been told to shut us down. We'd been close to uncovering evidence when we received the order to halt. The soil had begun yielding ash and cinders. Its color had changed from mahogany to graveyard black. We'd found a child's hair clip in the sifting screen, fragments of cloth, a tiny sneaker. Dear God, did the old woman's family really lie only inches below the point at which we'd stopped? 5 daughters and 9 grandchildren, shot, macheted, and burned in their home together with neighboring women and children. I imagine Signora Chip returning that day, perhaps descending the same dirt trail our team struggled down each morning and up each evening. She had sold her beans. She was probably happy. Then horror. How was it possible for human beings to do that to other human beings, to helpless and unresisting women and children? In the distance, I heard the rumble of thunder. Seconds, maybe years later, the interview stopped, an untranslated question left dangling in space. Mateo's back, said Elena Norvillo, an FAFG member from the El Petén region. I turned as she pushed to her feet. The rest of the team observed from under the tent. 2 men were working their way down one of the many footpaths that meandered through the gorge, the leader in blue windbreaker, faded jeans, brown cap. Though I couldn't read them from where I sat, I knew the letters above his brim said FAFG. The 6 of us waiting wore identical caps. The man following was suited and tied and carried a collapsible chair. When they drew within 20 yards, Elena shouted, "Did you get it?" Mateo gave a thumbs up. The injunction to suspend excavation had come from a local magistrate. According to his interpretation of the exhumation order, no work was to proceed outside the presence of a judge, the Guatemalan equivalent of a district attorney. Visiting early this morning and finding no judge on site, the magistrate had ordered digging halted. Mateo had gone to Guatemala City to have this ruling overturned. Mateo led his companion directly to the 2 uniformed guards, members of the National Civil Police, and produced a document. After a brief exchange with the suited visitor, the older of the 2 cops nodded. The villagers watched, silent but curious, as Juan, Luis, and Rosa stood and exchanged high fives. Mateo and his companion joined them at the well. Elena followed. Mateo introduced the suited man as Roberto Amado, a representative from the judge district attorney's office. The Guatemala City judge had ruled that Amado's presence would satisfy the requirements of the exhumation order. Amado would be with us for the duration, observing and recording in order to validate the quality of work for the court. Amado shook hands with each of us, moved to a corner of the covered area, unfolded his chair, and sat. Mateo began issuing orders. Luis, Rosa, please sift. Tempe and I will dig. Juan, haul dirt. We'll rotate as needed. Mateo had a small V-shaped scar on his upper lip that broadened into a U whenever he smiled. Today, the V remained narrow as a spike. Elena, document and photograph. Skeletal inventory, artifact inventory, photo log. Every molecule goes on record.
Where are Carlos and Molly? Asked Elena.
Carlos Menses was a member of an Argentine human rights organization who'd been advising the FAFG since its formation in 1992. Molly Carraway was an archaeologist newly arrived from Minnesota. They're driving the other truck out here for transport. We'll need another vehicle when we're ready to leave with all the equipment and artifacts. He glanced at the sky. The storm's 2 hours off, maybe 3 if we're lucky. Let's find these people before there's more legal bullshit. As I collected trowels and placed them in a bucket tied to a length of rope, Mateo zipped the court order into his pack and hung it over a crossbar. Tubes of muscle bulged in his neck and arms as he and Luis flung back the tarps covering the mouth of the excavation. Mateo placed a boot on the first of the dirt steps we'd terraced into a pit wall and slowly climbed down. When he reached bottom, I lowered the bucket, then descended as he had done, placing my feet sideways, testing each makeshift tread. Stepping off the last riser, I stood in a hole no more than 6 feet square. The walls and floor were slick, the air dank and rotten.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.